Hi, I have a privilege and to announce next speaker and Anya, welcome to Agile and afternoon Agile and Automation afternoons. Hello.
Hello, hello. Nice to see you.
Anna Radzikowska is currently working as a product manager of a Kanban maturity model. She's experienced in finance, training, and project management. What is really interesting is that she's a Kaizen culture and Kanban method passionate, but also an I assume passionate role-playing games player. And her role today will be to talk about eating, especially eating elephants and evolving. And that sounds pretty interesting, I would say. Ladies and gentlemen, Anya, stage is yours.
Thank you very much, Kuba. And before I even start, I would like to say big thank you to organizers of Agile and Automation Afternoons. I was very eager to attend Agile Automation Days. This year I was there last year and it was a great experience. It will stay with me for a long time. And to be honest, I couldn't wait to also go this year to Poznań and see you all guys again. But we have what we have. So once again, big thank you to everyone who were able to organize this Agile and Automation Afternoons. And I really hope that next year we'll be able to see face to face finally, like we did last year in Gdańsk. So see you there. But today, thank you very much to everyone who decided to spend this evening with me. My name is Anya, and I will be telling you today about humans and emotions. Because I know yesterday and even still today, you will have a chance to hear a lot of great technical talks. So you will have a short break with me from the technical talks. We'll be talking about emotions and reactions. And before we start, just a few more words. Who am I and why am I talking even about this? So first of all, I'm a storyteller. And not only by education, because you know I have graduated history at Jagiellonian University, was very, very long time ago. And I was taught how to teach children. So to teach children, you really need to be a storyteller. But also, as Kuba mentioned, I play role-playing games, classical paper, RPG, and I do it for 16 or 17 years already. Sometimes as player, sometimes as game master. So again, stories telling is part of my life and a crucial skill I need to have. I'm also a Kanban enthusiast and people devotee, and these both things go together because I always say, if you do Kanban, you need to love people, otherwise it simply doesn't work. And I believe that people are the most incredible and the most fantastic creatures in all over the world, and that's why I am very happy to be here with you, and hopefully we'll have a chance to answer some of your questions. And what I'm going to tell you about today, it will be about change. It will be about the change management. But to illustrate you this whole concept of change, and before I even go to the theory of change in our brains, a few words about my personal change management and the way I went through the last 2 years. So maybe you remember the Hobbit movie and the scene when Bilbo Baggins is running through the fields screaming, "I'm going on an adventure." So it was me, and it was me and my husband 2 years ago when we decided to take an adventure and buy a house. And we thought it would be good for us and for our small child to move from a small flat to the house nearby Kraków. And that day, it was the beginning of a huge adventure for us. And it may also happen to you that when you start any change in your life, smaller or bigger, at work, outside of work, you may see it as kind of an adventure that you need to take. And maybe someone told you one day that, you know, at the end of this adventure, you will see this and these benefits. But until you go there, you need to take yourself, of course, also your organization, your team, but first of all, yourself through this whole process of change. And for me, it was the journey and adventure, not only for me, but also for my whole family. And not only building a house, but something even worse from my personal perspective, which is removal. You know, I honestly and genuinely hate removals. And when I was thinking about moving all of this stuff from our small apartment where we collected these things for 14 years and pack everything, then move it to the house and unpack it again, I was sick, literally, emotionally and physically, I was sick thinking about it. And I knew that I have to do something with this emotion to be able to cope with it, because no one could do it for me. So this whole story of building house and removal was this huge elephant that appeared in my life and started to crush the pieces of glass of my perfect life. And probably you know the answer to this question, how to eat an elephant, because this is not my question. But before we go to that, I would like to tell you shortly about some theories behind how people's brain operate. And we'll start with Professor Daniel Kahneman. Professor Kahneman is a Nobel Prize winner in economy, but actually he is a psychologist. And for his whole life, he was studying human brains and how people behave, how people react to certain situations. And in one of his recent books, it was 2010, when he published this book, Thinking Fast and Slow, he described two systems that we have in our brain. Of course, this is simplification, but it was also the way how he visualized this concept. So we have system one, which is fast in terms of reactions. So reactions, emotions, these are the words associated with system one in our brain. And we have also system two, which is very slow because it takes information from our knowledge base. It takes information that we associate by learning and we acquired by learning. And system two, answering to the situations that happen to our life by system two, is very slow because it first needs to analyze different situations and only then it can answer. While system one answers immediately, and this is based on the reactions. And to give you an example of how these two systems differ, I will give you another example from my life. And again, 2 years ago. So this 2 years ago was pretty difficult year in my life from change perspective, because I decided to finally learn how to drive a car. So for all of this time living in Krakow, I actually didn't have to drive a car because everything was very close and it wasn't necessary for me. But when we already knew that we need to move nearby Krakow, but still this is a village, and my work and my child kindergarten probably will be in Krakow, I decided I need to learn how to drive a car. So I took driving lessons. It was something very new for me because by then I didn't even know how to switch on the car. So I took the theoretical driving lessons and then I started to learn how to really drive a car. So I'm not sure if you had similar experience, but the first moment when I stepped inside the car, I was very stressed. I didn't know what to do, how to turn left, how to turn right. I had to remember about all of these things, buttons I need to push, and about the teacher next to me, and even more about everything that's happening around me. So people, other cars, trams, buses, you know, there were so many elements that I need to remember, which I was not yet able to react to. So this was the moment when in my life I operated on the level of system two. So everything I have learned, my system two started to analyze. So before I turned left, I had to analyze what I need to do to turn left. And it took time. But then after this 30, 40 hours of learning how to drive a car, then finally passing getting my driving license and another lessons, because these were still lessons without the teacher, but I was still learning how to drive a car by myself then. This was a process when my system two, which analyzed the situation that's happening on the road, taught system one how to react. And right now, after these 2 years, every day driving the car, Most of the things I'm doing happens on the system one level. So I operate on the reactions level. I don't need to actively think what I need to do to turn left or right. I just do it. And at the same time, I can listen to radio, I can talk to my husband, which was unimaginable for me at the beginning. So you could think, why do we really need system one if we could analyze everything based on system two and we could live in our perfect logic world? Actually, system one is something what Mother Nature left in the process of evolution for us. You can imagine that people at the beginning, our ancestors sitting in the bush, didn't have time to reanalyze, is this sound somewhere in the woods a lion that wants to eat me, or maybe we should discuss, or maybe we should proceed it further? No, our ancestor just get up and ran away, and it helped our species to survive. So this is what we still need, because even referring to our road situations, sometimes when accident is very close, we don't analyze should we avoid this accident or not. We just try to avoid the accident. And everything happens on the reactions and emotions level. So this is why we need system one. But also system one can be our enemy when it comes to situations like the change. And if you ever encounter a situation in your life that someone came to you and told you, so now we are going to reorganize our department, or we are going to create new jobs and new roles, and now you, dear project manager, will be called a Scrum Master, and you receive the whole list of benefits as a result of this change, your system two can say, okay, I understand it, yes, we'll have a lot of benefits and we'll be fine. But the same moment your system one says, oh no, I don't like it, I really like to be project manager, or I really like to be Scrum Master, don't change anything in my life. So again, it takes time for system one to learn and to be taught by system two how to operate in the new environment. And what we see as a traditional model of change management was described in 1920s by McKinsey. And this is the model that you can see here. So the traditional change model assumes that we have point A, the current process. And from this current process, we travel easily and straightforward to point B, which is the future process, which is in advance described and defined. But unfortunately, this is not so easy. And maybe some of you already experienced it. Because the change process looks rather like J curve. So what you can see is like a huge J letter reversed. And this is what we use in our Kanban words to really describe how the change process looks. So, okay, you start at some A point, so some current process. But then eventually at some point of time, you come to the moment when you experience a drop in the change process. And it can be a drop in motivation. It can be a drop in the engagement. Sometimes even the business outcomes of your organization. And the deeper you go in this hole in the J curve, the less safety you keep for yourself in this whole process. So on vertical line, we have our capability and we have our safety level. And what you can see on the horizontal line is the time. And this time also is referred to the patience of your patients, your company, your managers, your colleagues. So the longer it takes for you to stay in this hole at the bottom, the more difficult it may be for you to get out of this hole and start to see the benefits of the change. And if you operate in the lower maturity organization, it may be the moment when the managers, especially the ones responsible for the budget, may feel that this change agent or agile coach maybe are not so great as we thought when we hired them, so they should be fired and we hire another change manager and another agile coach, which is actually not their fault that it happened the way, it's rather the fault of the process and the system that was introduced to go through the to take organization through the change process. So how we can do it better? You can look at this green line. So what we suggest for you to do? Not design your change as one huge step from A to B or one huge elephant, if you want to stick to this metaphor. Rather try to eat your elephant piece by piece. So do small steps, because this way, on one hand, you don't drop very deep in your safety level, and on the second hand, horizontally, you don't require so much patience to take you and your organization through these small changes. And how does it work? So again, we are in the initial process, so there is no change to McKinsey model from last century. And from this initial process, we take one small step. And when we take this one small step, we observe what's happening, how our organization, our team, our department, how we react to the change. We evaluate fitness of the change to all of these levels of our organization. And if this change is good, we take the next step. And again, we evaluate the change. Then we take the next step, and again, we evaluate the change. And we do the small steps also to introduce after each step a very quick and short feedback loop, which will provide us with information that we can use for further improvement. So it may happen that even if we designed our change process to go one direction, it may happen that we need to change the path because we see it from the feedback that we received from the environment, that this is not the good direction. We need to find another way. But it also may happen that when we evaluate fitness, we see that the change wasn't good for us and we need to roll back. And again, because the change was very small, it's easy to roll back. Sometimes the change is so small that no one even noticed that you did it. So there is no resistance from the organization and from people around you to roll back the small change because it doesn't hurt so much. And again, you evaluate fitness. If it's okay, you move forward. And you evaluate fitness and so on and so forth. And the future process is not designed, but it's emergent. So we achieve this process by assessing the change all the time and gathering feedback all the time. And this is how we should approach the change as the process which is evolving and not going strictly straightforward line from A to B when we don't know if B is actually the point where we want to be. And how did it work for me? So what you can see here is actually my house and plan for my house. So when I started to think about it, as I said, it was a very, very huge elephant, which I couldn't even think about as a whole. Because what I knew was that I want a house and I want it to be pretty, which you can imagine are pretty shallow requirements. So what I did, because it wasn't yet ready, I made kind of a virtual trip through it. So I closed my eyes and I went through a virtual door. And I saw, okay, here I have main room and I have a kitchen. Then I go upstairs, room 1, 2, 3, 4, and the bathroom. So this was the first step to really divide our elephant, our huge change, and my house into smaller pieces. Smaller, maybe less complex, because size is not necessarily the one we are looking for. So I made this house less complex. And dividing it into rooms was already decreasing the complexity. So then I started to think from the room's perspective. So let's think about the kitchen. Is kitchen complexity small enough for me, or I need to decrease it further? So yes, I had to decrease it further because my kitchen consists of furniture, cups, cutlery, maybe some curtains. And what I started to do, I started to put all of these elements on the board. So what you can see here, you may associate to the Kanban board, which is kind of the Kanban board, but it has nothing to do with Kanban systems, to be clear. But this is completely another story. So what I tried to achieve was to put everything what I had in my head somewhere externally. And I also used the color coding, and I divided my house into the smaller, the least complex possible pieces. Looking from a work perspective, you can think about it as the least complex possible tasks. And this kind of approach has some significant benefits. I will just tell you about two of them, which were the most important for me that moment. The first one I already mentioned. So I cleaned up my brain from thinking about this. And this is what I would like to encourage you to do. You have beautiful brains. You have smart brains. Don't overload them with such a mess that you just need to remember about. Use external tools. Use Excel file, I know, PowerPoint, notes. Use any tools like Trello, Kanban Flow, anything what you have for free. And you can easily use to clean up your brain and make space for thinking about something more important or more creative. Let the tools keep these annoying tasks for you. So create this external memory. So this is what I did, and it gave me huge relief that even if I forget about something, I have it somewhere externally. So I didn't feel this pressure of remembering about all of this stuff. On the other hand, because I didn't work alone, this visualization helped me and my husband to work together on the tasks we need to go through. And because I also use some descriptions, some color coding, as I mentioned, we could easily assign ourselves to this work. So if he saw that, I don't know, right now I'm taking care for buying curtains to the kitchen, he knew that he doesn't need to think about it. So it was my task. And it also served for the cooperation. So we didn't, of course, we talked to each other, but we didn't have to talk all the time to each other. When I was at work, he could easily check what we are doing and where we are with our process. And this is also, it can be also useful for you. Because I assume that you are not lonely islands and you have people around you, even if sometimes you have specialists role and you don't have a team, you normally cooperate with the other people. So to make the work transparent, to make work visible, and to enhance this cooperation, it's good to make all of these things available for everyone. What's in it for me, you may ask. So again, if I would like you to take one or two small pieces from this presentation that you can start to implement next Monday, because this is our goal, maybe not next Monday, maybe even tomorrow. The things I would like to ask you for is apply small evolutionary change in your life. So don't try to bite the change at once. Eat your elephant one piece at a time. Take small steps and apply this approach not only at work, but also apply this approach at your life to anything what requires from you an effort and change. And the other small piece, try to use external sources, external tools. If you don't do it yet, don't overburden yourself, don't overwhelm yourself with remembering about stuff that can be just put somewhere outside. And last but not least, remember about people and values. Because, as I mentioned, we do not operate as lonely islands. So I would like to encourage collaboration and agreement so that everyone knows what we do and why we do it this way. And last but not least, respect. Respect for everyone as human beings and respect for who we are, what is our experience, what we can bring to others people life. Good luck with your change. Thank you very much for your time. And now it's the questions time.
And we are quite on schedule. We have like 10 minutes, so I can ask some questions. Currently, we have three, and I will start with my own because I know it the best. So basically, if we are in the middle of a change and we're chewing too large a bit, so the long change, this long, wrong J-shaped process that you described in the beginning, do you know a way how to persuade the manager not to cut it in the middle or and just let it rise?
First of all, I will give you the answer that is probably the favorite answer of agile coaches and auditors. It depends. But to give you some examples, I say it depends because it depends on your manager and on the needs of your manager. And I always start with needs and trying to understand what's the goal of the other person. So say, maybe I will just give you an example. I had a manager who was concerned about the budget. So when we did a project, she was a budget owner, so everything had to be within the budget because we were not able to get additional funding for this project. And to support her decision-making, she wanted from us a lot of reports and a lot of statistics. But actually her need was to keep the things in schedule and in budget. And when I think about her and her needs, if when we were, because it was also kind of traditional McKinsey change. So we were in the middle of huge drop in our efficiency from the project perspective and also from the business perspective. And actually, we couldn't turn back, but also we couldn't move forward. So what we started to do, we collected data. Because when you have information and when you have data, you start to build a history of what you have done. And also based on the data, you can start to predict the future. So we are not estimating based on the gut feelings and what we think may be useful, but we really start to forecast the future based on data. And for her, it was very helpful because she was operating on this level of information. She needed data, she needed numbers, and she needed a precise forecast for future. And it also gave her kind of an assurance that we know what we do, even if the whole situation seems to stuck for a moment and we don't know how to move further. You also may have a different kind of people who don't take care about data, but they are just micromanagers and they want to manage the time of everyone. So again, it's good to look at the people's needs. I would start from this and then try to adjust your actions to what to the way how they operate and the way how they think. And I don't know who asked this question, but if you have any specific example, I'm really happy to talk about it offline.
No, that was my question. That's really my question. So yeah, I can give you examples later on.
Yeah.
But let's go to Michał's question. What in case of another change coming in when we still did not finish implementing the last one? How to approach it?
Oh gosh, this is my favorite question, but probably would need another few hours to answer it.
And by the way, I kind of feel that it is connected to the next question that showed up, which is how not to be in a situation of everlasting change process in step-by-step process of change. And I mean, you can approach them together.
Yeah, so first of all, when I said that we take it step by step, I don't mean that we throw away the McKinsey idea that we want to reach point B ultimately. So we always should have a goal in our mind. So why we really do it? Is it, do we need to improve our system? Do we have any requests from the customer side? So we should have this final goal in our heads, but the difference is how we achieve this goal. So it all depends how you are constrained in terms of time and how you really operate in your process. Do you have any fixed date when you need to deliver your work? Or you have to just deliver the work and you don't operate within the fixed dates, but rather within SLAs. So it all depends on your process and on your organization. So I wouldn't say that we stuck in everlasting change process. I would rather think about how to achieve the goal based on do we have SLAs or we have fixed date for this goal, and try to achieve this goal, but again, looking at the data, because, you know, I had 2 years project plan planned, and I had a budget for this project, and I knew what I should achieve at the end of this project. But how we do it was on us, actually. So I knew that I cannot treat what I'm doing as everlasting process. I need to achieve something in 2 years' time. But to be able to achieve it, I started to look at historical data. And if you don't have your own historical data, start to look at the data from some, from any similar project or process. If you don't have any similar project or process, the next step is to just assume something and then start introduce the change in a small steps to be able to gather feedback and be able to adjust your assumptions to the current situation. So that's why I'm talking about short feedback loops, and that's why I'm talking about small steps, because having small steps, you have data that helps you to adjust yourself to be able to reach this point. And of course, at some point of time, you may realize that maybe the goal was over-optimistic or you are not able to achieve it. But then when you have a data, you can also use this data to talk to your stakeholders, to talk to your customers, to show them what you are able to achieve. And you tell it to them in the process, not at the end of the process, when after 2 years you know that you are not able to deliver anything to them. And Kuba, can you go back to the previous question?
Exactly.
What in case another change comes in when we still did not finish implementing? So this is a question about balancing demand and capability. So another change is demand from our customer, no matter who this customer is. It can be internal customer, so someone from our company that wants something from us. It can be external customer, so we get another financial engagement. And on the other hand, we need to look at our capability and our capacity too. So how we are able to meet this demand. If we are already occupied by the current change process and we see from the capability analysis that we are not able to meet this demand, and this is a question to decision makers. So now we look from the benefits perspective. What is more beneficial for us? To stop current process, project, building current product. And again, we have different scenarios here, so you can discard this project or you can shelve this project. So it may happen that it's more beneficial to wait with current project for another time and another opportunity, and it makes more sense to start another project in the meantime. Or maybe this new opportunity is not so beneficial as we thought. But again, to be able to take this decision, we again need data, because without data, you will not be able to talk to the ones who comes to you with demand that you are or you are not able to meet this demand.
Okay, no more questions now. If you guys have any more, please ask them in the comments. And Anya promised to have a look there.
Yes.
In YouTube. And Anya, thank you very much.
One more thing, I almost forgot. Every time after live sessions, but also now after online sessions, I invite everyone for a coffee. So if you are somewhere in Krakow or nearby Krakow, I invite you for a coffee if you want to talk to me about Kanban, but not only, about everything that's related to change and process management or product building. We can also engage in online coffee. So I'm open for discussion, and just ping me over LinkedIn, I think is the best option, and we can chat. So feel invited. Thank you very much. It was a great pleasure for me. See you.
Thank you. Thank you for being here for us.